Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to take a closer look at the operation of the Seplos Batteries BMS system, or battery management system. So I was hoping to actually first do a video of the general overview of my solar powered carport, which can charge my Nissan Leaf and can run my cabin for a certain part of the day. So I've decided to go into at least this first video with an initial more detailed look at the battery management system and my feeling about the Seplos battery. This whole project, which is now I'd say 95 to 98% complete, barring a few fun and games with changes with the NEC or National Electrical Code, in particular DC breakers, which are a can of worms, and also DC fault protection, which I'm now going to add. So I'm busy doing this update. There's loads of other little bits and pieces which have been quite challenging with this project, which I'm going to have more detailed videos on. But I say I will do an overview video first, and then we'll do, just like this video, little in-depth dives into certain aspects of the system. Anyway, the Seplos battery and its BMS. So first off, you'll know the one whole challenge behind this whole project has been trying to find a battery system which will potentially pair up and work with an inverter and be able to manage the BMS, let's say, via a system like either CAN bus or RS485. Now in fact, I made a separate video which I've gone and ditched because things have changed since I've made it, but there's a whole video where I go into more detail about CAN bus, its history and the challenges of why it can be so difficult for, let's say, battery manufacturers and inverter manufacturers to get their devices to talk to each other. The long and the short of it is basically you've got a standard for CAN bus. There are several iterations of CAN bus. You've got a physical layer describing the wiring. You've got a data link layer describing the protocol and the handshaking. And then you've got an application layer where basically each manufacturer can design its communication protocol and its data packaging. And that is up to each vendor, how they go and design what data they want in there and the format of that data. So unless, let's say, an inverter has the understanding of that data packet that is coming along, how it's formatted, what data is in there, it's not going to understand it. So each battery system has to talk the language, or at this application level, of the inverter. There are, for other industries where it's like car diagnostics and things like that, there are open standards which people can use so that it's very easy to manufacture devices or create devices which are going to work because you understand the protocol. It's open. But so far as I can see, there is no open BMS or standard BMS data structure which people are using. So until that happens, there's going to be this problem. And again, because of that, and also hardware issue on my GrowWatt inverter, I do not have CAN bus communicating with the inverter. It's operating in a dumb mode, just with a charge voltage level and a cutoff level. And I'm totally reliant on the Seplos BMS to manage itself. So in some respects, that's kind of been good. It's allowed me to really focus heavily on the Seplos BMS to make sure it's operating correctly. And I do want to tip my hat to Seplos, because there have been at some points in this journey where I've got very frustrated with them. You know, they advised me to go and get or purchase a GrowWatt inverter because their battery systems work with GrowWatt. But unbeknownst to them, GrowWatt currently, if you go look at the model, the 3000 watt inverter that I've got two because they stacked to provide split phase. They say in there that it supports RS485 and CAN bus. However, there's been a hardware change within the last year. We specifically had to go down and look at the dates on my communication boards, which support BMS, to go and see this. And they're only literally just outside of a year old. But there was a change where the previous versions of this little communication board only supported RS485. It states that inside my manual, but not in the manual or the documentation on the GrowWatt web currently. So if you go onto the web, say, it supports CAN bus, but you happen to buy one which is slightly older, you might come unstuck. And that's the situation I'm in. More of that in another video. But anyway, what I'm going to do in this video, we're going to go and have a quick look at the setup, the wiring, you'll see it, and then focus on the SetPlus BMS. And I'm going to show you video inserts taken with my phone, because I've been running in and out when certain things are happening, when I'm charging, discharging, and things are balancing, and just taking some video with my phone. It's not the best, but you'll get the idea of what I'm talking about. So let's go take a look. Right then, so just to give you a little bit of an understanding what it's like today, you can see I've got the setup, the solar panels. I have my Nissan Leaf plugged in. I've already had 3 days of it charging from the sun, but of course today with it raining and cloudy skies, that just ain't happening. However, I want to say that these cloudy skies actually bring in more light at this part of the day, because it is only just after 11. I only get light coming over the hill and through the trees at about 12:30. So having the clouds brings more light, because light is dispersed and there's already charge going into the batteries because of that. But anyway, let's go take a closer look. Right, then a quick bit of freehand just to show you the setup over here. I'm going to go into more detail when I do the overview video, but there are the two inverters. Here is a wiring. I've got an AC side over there, the DC side over here, which I've got the breakers, which either disconnect the battery or disconnect the solar arrays. And again, I'm on a second set of DC breakers, and I'm going to change those out again. More detail about that in another video. But I have all the wiring set up to each of the inverters. I have the grid that comes in and goes back to the cabin as well. That'll be explained. And then obviously I've got the solar panel cabling coming in, which obviously gets split up between both inverters. We then have the SetPlus batteries. You'd have seen these before, but specifically today we're going to concentrate on the BMS and look at how that functions. You can see I've got the communication cables in place, which run to both of the inverters, but I said that is non-functional. Currently, it's been set up as a user configuration, so it's been used in a dumb mode. I'm hoping I can get updated boards. I have sent a request to the gent, actually a South African gent who sells the GrowWatt inverters in the States, to see if he can get me the updated board, and then I can get that all set up and figured out. But for now, let's just have a look at the BMS. Then just a note, in the background you will see I've got a 240 volt outlet over there with the, it's not a charger, this is an electrical interface to the charger within the car. And I've gone through several of these in order to not overload the inverters. I'll explain more about that again in the overview, but this, what they call EV charger, which it's not really, you can adjust the current setting. So this one is a level 2. It can do both level 1, so 120 volt, 240 volt. I'm obviously using it on 240 volt, but you can switch between 6, 8, 10, 13, and a 16 amp charge. I've got it set at 6, but again, I'll explain more about that in the overview video. Right, so on the interface into the actual battery pack, I've done a previous video showing the software and how it connects. This uses RS485. I have got 4 battery packs. You have to set various dip switch settings to be able to address all those packs. Each of these packs is rated for 100 amp hour with a nominal voltage of 48 volts. So in total with those figures, you get just over 5 kilowatt hours per pack, which means I've got 20 kilowatt hours in total in this pack. The actual voltage ranges of this pack, the cutoff voltage is around 41.6 volts per pack, and the kind of charge voltage is 54.5. However, when you're using it in the dumb mode, what you want is to ensure that then the internal BMS actually runs it. So the voltage setting on the inverter is 56 volts, and that ensures that the internal BMS to the batteries actually then controls when it cuts off, stops charging. And you can obviously set, if you don't want to take a go to 100% depth of discharge, you can obviously set your own cutoff so that you can preserve some of the energy in the battery and then perhaps prolong, get more cycles out of it. You can set that parameter on the inverter. But on this, what you'll note is it does cycle through the packs. You'll see it going through 1, 2, 3, 4. You'll also note that this needle, and I'm going to explain why one of the packs, the top pack number 1, which is the DIY pack, which I put together, you can see is not at the same level of charge as the others. So the reason for that is that when I put that pack together, in essence, it was a brand new pack, and the BMS didn't know what its actual capacity was. So when it first sees a new battery, it assumes the rated capacity of 100 amp hour. Now, in reality, you're not exactly going to have 100 amp hour, and this BMS is intelligent enough, once it's gone through a full proper cycle, so a full top up and then going right down to its cutoff voltage, it can calculate the actual capacity for each pack. Now, when I first installed the pack, well, I followed the instructions from Seplos, perhaps not exactly as I should have. Basically, what you do is you charge the pack up and then discharge it. But I did all the packs together. So because you got all the packs together, when they discharge, you're not necessarily going to get the proper cutoff for an individual pack. So yesterday, I then disconnected all the other packs and I just had the top pack connected. And I then fully charged it and discharged it. So up until that point in time, the capacity was showing 100 amp hour, whereas now you can see cycling through these range from about 102 point something up, or 101 point something to 110. They say within their specs, it could be anywhere from about 98 amp hour upwards. And I say, I'm quite surprised to see that one is at 110. So anyway, I did that. I obviously discharged it and the others were still sitting at 70%. So I discharged it, it was the end of the day, I then connected all the packs up and then it intelligently, carefully brought it up from where it was at quite a low setting to close to where they are. And I'm going to talk about this close to and what the kind of figures are and how it balances everything. So what these packs aim to achieve, and if you look at the figure over there, the voltage difference, there are 16 cells in each of these packs. And you can see the software will show you all the individual cells and the individual voltages, and it'll give you a delta across the pack. And that is what you're seeing here, voltage difference. And its goal is to get to 2 millivolts across those 16 cells, which is quite incredible. So it's 2/1000ths of a volt. And you can see here, basically, it is almost there. That'll change depending on obviously how much current you're pulling out or putting into the pack. I've seen a difference of, let's say, 17, 20, maybe sometimes in extreme cases, 30 millivolts under extreme load. But then it works to bring it back, I say, to literally almost 2 millivolts. And you can see it's almost there. Currently, even though it's raining, there's still some power coming in from the solar array. And you can see this is what it does. It'll intelligently distribute the power. So it can see that these other packs have got a higher charge and it is putting more current into pack one. So if you keep an eye on how this is flicking around, pack one, it is providing more power to it. So what this BMS is doing, it's obviously doing a host of intelligent activities. For one, it is ensuring that you don't overcharge. It'll protect against a short circuit. It'll protect against overcurrent. So it's got all those protections built in. But when it's operating normally, its two key tasks are to balance all the cells and then to balance between the packs. So I've already mentioned 2 millivolts across the cells. And in terms of balancing across the packs, it tries to keep them to within roughly anywhere between 20 and 40 millivolt is what I've noticed. So if you look here, we've got 9.6, 9.4, 5.6. So basically it is within 20 millivolt and that's what it's doing. It'll constantly balance the current both when it's under load, pulling current out and obviously charging. It'll do that. And let's say even when it's not charging, it'll, even between the packs, it'll distribute current to bring a pack back into line. And I must say, I've been very impressed with how well it works between the cells and between the packs. I'll just insert a couple of video shots here where, let's say under heavy load, where I can show you where it'll distribute the amount of current coming out. It'll change the current draw across the packs to ensure that it's keeping this balance between the packs. And then when you're charging it, again, it carefully distributes the charge. And I say, at the moment, because we haven't got much current coming in, there's not too much of a differential, but I say in that video, you'll see there can be, it'll push a fair amount of current to a pack which isn't within balance. Now, once it's within balance, so once it's brought these all up, and their voltage levels are fairly similar, then we'll have the capacity, which is fairly similar. But then we'll basically across the packs, we'll have a fairly good balance. And I say, that's the test for me in the next few days, is now that I've done this calibration, is to see how well balanced the actual capacity measurement is as I charge them and discharge them. Right, so then this software, I must say, has also been very handy. So for one, I'm impressed with the amount of information and data that you've got. So besides all the cells and what have you, you can see the state of health. You can see the actual bus voltage across the cells, which is being presented to the inverters. You can see how many times they've cycled. Now, the one thing I'll note here, the cycle time, it's noting like 22 times, I think 24 on one of these. That's not a full cycle. I think what happens is once you've gone into a charge state and then gone into a discharge state, it counts that as a cycle. It's something I want to speak to Seplos about, because I say that it's not really reflecting a true full cycle of the battery. You can then see you've got a whole lot of temperatures, ambient, and of the battery packs. The BMS software itself is upgradable, so if they make any changes or improvements, you can actually update the BMS software or firmware. I've already done that already. It also has a real-time data logger, which I have found extremely handy. So I've got this running at the moment. I'll just push the stop. But across here, it'll obviously show you the event number. It'll show you across each battery pack, they're labeled 1, 2, 3, 4. The date, the time, and the mode. Currently they're in a standby mode because they're not, no real power is being pulled out. They're just doing a very slow charge. And then if you go across all these columns, you can see the cell voltages across all the cells. You can see a cell differential. You can see the battery temperatures, ambient. You've got the current. So if I go right down to the bottom at the moment, you can see that the small level of current that's being put into the cells, even under these rainy conditions. You can see the capacity, the amp hour, the state of charge, the rated capacity, the cycle time. So it has all the critical information which is being recorded. You can then go and save it. So I'll go and save it. You can see I've already saved quite a few files here. As I've been monitoring the system, and the reason I've been doing this is to get the settings right on the inverter to basically disconnect at night, run off grid, and then reconnect in the morning when solar is available. And again, I'll explain all the settings and why and my logic behind the settings once we have the general overview. So you can save that. What I'm going to do right now, I'll go and clear these settings and I'll start to run again. And if I click run, you'll see once every second, it'll take a reading from each pack. I'll just go back. And you can see the packs are labeled 1, 2, 3, 4, and it's sequentially going through them each second and then logging all the data. So I must say, I have been really impressed by the software and the tools. So let me do a little bit of nitpicking, because it's not all perfect. The one thing I know, I think would have been nice, you can do, because you've got CSV or Excel spreadsheet files. I could go and get a cumulative watt hour or amp hour from these, but it would be nice, let's say, to have a clock that resets at midnight so I could see the total amp hours that have gone in and out of the packs at a glance. Again, it's not a critical thing, it just would be a nice to have. The one thing I think that could be better done is that some of the warning messages that come up here, and I'll again insert a little video clip here, and if you have a look at some of those warning messages, they don't quite make sense. Like, they use the term pressure in terms of, let's say, voltage. And some of the direct translation, even I cannot make out what the actual error message means. So I think Seplos could do a little better task there. I do know the folk that I've been communicating with, their written skills are brilliant. Certainly when you speak to them over, I speak over WhatsApp when I've been communicating with them, that can be a little bit challenging. They're not used to spoken English. but their written English is really good. And I think some of those folks should get involved with, I say, some of the error messages are not translated in the best way. But again, not a showstopper. I've been really impressed. So let's just go back and talk about what I'm able to do with 20 kilowatt hours in terms of charging the vehicle and my cabin. Right then, so what is that battery pack able to provide for me? It's got 20 kilowatt hours, and I've done several tests. So my first test was to try and take it up and then fully discharge it. This was one of those days when I was trying to get the pack that I put together balanced. I say I was doing it in the pack, which wasn't the correct way. Isolating it and doing it as an individual pack is the way to do it if you're in the same situation. But basically at about 9:30 in the morning, I switched my cabin to totally run off the pack, and I was hoping I had all the lights on. I had a lot more running than I normally have running. And just to note, I don't have a subset of circuits that I run off the system. I run everything. So there are two air conditioning units. They're split units. I generally only run one. I've got two small water heaters for my hot water, my computer, all the lighting. The stove or range is also on there. And so basically by 5 o'clock that evening, I was hoping the pack could be fairly run down. Now, bear in mind that my cabin is fairly efficient. I, on average, only use about 750 to 850 watts. So across a 24-hour period, I only use somewhere between 20 kilowatt hours and 24 kilowatt hours. 24 kilowatt hours at the outside. Generally, it's probably 20 kilowatt hours or less. So this cabin can run off that pack with no sun for 24 hours. But on this day when I was doing this test, I hit about 5 o'clock, 5:30, and I was thinking, well, it's time to go home. So I put on a space heater. I switched on the stove, one of the plates on the stove. At that point in time, I had both air conditionings on heating, but I was now adding heat, so they were switching off. So I switched them over to cool. So they were fighting the heating, and I still was here until 9 or 9:30 at night trying to run that pack down. Eventually, I managed to run it down, but I say that is the capability of both the inverters and the amount of energy inside that pack. I say running things to extreme. So certainly on my normal usage, I could run this for 24 hours. I could probably run for 3 days. So eventually, because of the things I leave on at night, I've got a gaming computer I use for video editing, which is fairly power hungry. I obviously leave the air conditioning unit on. There are a few other bits and pieces. And because of that, if I'm charging the car, if I wasn't charging the car, it would be a different story. But if I'm charging the vehicle, which needs 6 kilowatt hours, more about that I say in the overview video, but 6 kilowatt hours, which I can get in the period that I've got peak sun, I can charge the car, run the cabin, and then put charge back into the battery, but I wouldn't be able to get it back to 100%. So I reckon over a course of 2 to 3 days, I'd eventually run dry. Now let's say I was in a situation where there is a total power outage. I wouldn't charge the car, let's say. I could power things off at night. I could then potentially run perpetually off the grid from that solar array that I've got. But again, I say more of that about that when the sun is out and it's not raining. I can give you that overview. So that is the little insight into the BMS on the Seplos battery system. I'm very impressed. It operates very well. And I say, even though it's operating in a dumb mode where it doesn't have intelligent communications to the inverter, it looks after itself entirely on its own. And that's an important thing, because as I'm beginning to realize, it can be very difficult still to interface a battery pack with an inverter. But if you have a battery pack like the Seplos system, which can manage itself and operate in a dumb mode, you don't have to have that intelligent communication. You can just set some key settings like your absorb or your charge voltage and your cutoff on the inverter, And in the case certainly of the Seplos system, it can totally manage itself to within very small tolerances, 2 to 4 millivolts across the 16 cells in each pack, and to about 20 millivolts, 20 to 30 millivolts across all the packs together. So I have been very impressed, and I must say hats off to them, and I say thanks very much for allowing me to have a closer look at these packs. But anyway, hopefully in the next video, we're going to have a general overview of the wiring, earthing system, and all the challenges. It'll be an overview, and then I'm going to branch off into separate videos detailing what to consider if you're going to do a project like this yourself. Anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.